Hi, I guess it's post lunch hour, trying hard to stay awake, a lot of people here. So quickly coming, I think because we're running short of time, just don't want to waste too much time around this. We thought we'll jump straight to the topic. It's about making of a challenger brand, right? And trying to define, I think for the last hour, we were all sitting together and trying to define what exactly a challenger brand is. And what are they doing? So literally the answer lies in that statement. So what are they doing? They're actually challenging. They're challenging everything from status quo, they're challenging product categories, they're challenging customer experiences. So we have with us the entire panel of people who are actually running a bunch of challenger brands in itself, right? They are challenging all these things that we were talking about. I'm going to let them kind of give you an intro into what they do, but largely also to get a perspective, I'll start off with maybe if you guys could introduce yourself and give your take on what you consider a good challenging brand or a good challenger brand or so, and why is it so? Do you want to start off?
Yeah. Hi guys, good afternoon. My name is Anupam Boke and I run a brand called 2Yum with RP Sanjeev Goenka Group. I'm the chief marketing officer. Well, 2Yum is one of the challenger brands. Let's start it that way. But I think within the question is, I think there is an intent to check whether a large brand can also be a challenger brand. So I think a challenger brand is, I define somebody who challenges established conventions. For example, if it's a payment online, Paytm could be a challenger brand, and it's possibly very large. PayPal at one stage was a challenger brand. If you're a car rental company, Avis is a challenger brand. So I think wherever you are trying to change conventions and do something different, then I think the brand can dawn. So there is not one brand which you can consider as, you know, an idol of challenger mentality, but I think all the examples that I'm sharing, depending on what genre they are addressing, which category they play, they found a need gap or an aspect which can be differentially delivered as a solution, and they all took that challenger stance. So I think there are several, some of them I mentioned, and I think this is my list of challenger brands. We can discuss more when we go forward.
Hi, I'm Saurabh. I am founder of No Broker. No Broker is a real estate platform that connects owners, tenants, buyers, sellers directly without any broker, without any brokerage. I don't know if any of you know how much brokerage is paid in India. Any guess? No, in terms of amount. How many crores of, or how many millions of brokerage is paid every year? 5,000 crores? 10,000? It's $19 billion. It's 1,40,000 crores. Every year, 1,40,000 crores is paid as brokerage by all of us. And I think No Broker started from there. I was living in Bombay and I paid a brokerage of 80,000 and it really hurt. And the broker came back again next year saying, ki sir, wapas chahiye brokerage mere ko. That was a tipping point. And so No Broker was started in 2014. It's been 6 years. We are present in 6 cities, Mumbai, Bangalore, Pune, Chennai, Hyderabad, Delhi, NCR. Every year we do transaction worth 10,000 crores now. We are saving 1,200 crores in brokerage every year now. Still, we're just scratching the surface because the total amount is much, much larger. We have raised 850 crores in funding as of date. Talking about the challenger brand, I think No Broker, of course, is a big challenger brand because we're trying to disrupt the brokers who have been there and disrupt other players who were working with brokers. But to my mind, I think one very strong example which I always think and which has been some kind of an inspiration when we started No Broker is a company called Craigslist. I don't know if many of you have heard about it. It's a classified in the US, and now they operate in actually 70 countries, started in 99 as an email list, and they started disrupting the classified which comes in the newspaper. So newspaper classified had thousands of people on ground that they were doing some revenue. Craigslist has 50 employees, It does $1 billion in revenue every year. Per person, per employee revenue, highest in the world. They have almost zero marketing expense because they realize that, I think there's a simple customer pain point. I don't want to look at a newspaper when everything, every information is available online. And $1 billion revenue, and I believe their profit is some $700 million. So I really think that's a very, very strong challenger brand.
Yeah. My name is Vignesh, and I'm the founder of The News Minute. We'd like to see ourselves as a very progressive digital-only platform which focuses on the news space. And our specialty is we focus only on the southern states. Just focusing on the media sector, you know, I see that a lot of independent websites are there which I consider as challenging brands to the legacy, you know, newspapers and publications which, you know, like the Times of India and the NDTVs, you know, of the country. We've always been used to media outlets which are legacy backed, you know, extending over many, many years of, you know, their foundations. From our perspective, what we've done differently is we knew from the very beginning that we would never be able to defeat or disrupt Times of India or an NDTV. But we always knew that we could challenge them in our own little way. Okay, and so what we did is we started focusing on the news space, which operated out of the five southern states. I mean, when we started it was four, but right now it's five. And how we've done that is basically we've understood that, you know, a lot of the media narrative in the country is focused on what happens in Delhi and what happens in Bombay. There were a lot of very good stories which came out of the south, especially, you know, from a hyperlocal perspective or even the tier one and tier two cities down in south, which are never making it to the national, you know, news agendas. In the last 6 years, I think that we've challenged that quotient very much, and we've been able to bring South India from a news perspective onto the national, you know, legacy brands.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Sai, and I run marketing for Paisa Bazaar, Policy Bazaar Group. So I think very fortunate to be running the as you call the quintessential challenger brands, because financial services largely was. Largely was called as the push category, where either an agent would come and sell you an insurance, or, you know, you have to go to your nearest bank to get a loan, and that entire myth was challenged, and that status quo was challenged by a category where, you know, from being a push category, we became a pull category, where, you know, consumers started coming to us, coming to the platform, and started comparing. And also, one of the things that we started doing was we started even questioning the consumers. We also challenged the consumers of the way they were buying. So, also questioning the status, moving the status quo of the consumer, of changing this mindset of the consumer, of, you know, the way they were buying. So, so I think that was these were two examples which I could think of that from our own category that we could say that of the challenger brand. Having said that, this challenger brand is, again, as we were discussing today in the panel, is not really even a market leader can also be a challenger brand. So yeah, pretty much that. Yeah.
Thank you, and afternoon, everyone. I'm Siddharth. I work with AirAsia India. It's a joint venture in the aviation space between Tata Sons Private Limited and the AirAsia Group. AirAsia is actually a consortium of eight independent airlines operating in different countries. When it comes to challenger brands, and we were speaking about this a bit earlier, I tend to agree with the point that a market leader can also be a challenger, and essentially anybody who's entered the market at some point of time potentially starts off as a challenger. Even if you take controversial examples who are no longer challengers, but the likes of a Google, for instance, or an Apple, when they started off, they were challengers. If you look closer to when the gig economy started, or even the likes of other disruptors in spaces where they have essentially moved away from old models, taking the space of where an aggregator used to play. Similarly, in financial services, et cetera, I would argue that, for instance, Airbnb is a challenger brand. And if you look at other sectors entirely, two of the sectors that come to mind, particularly there's in financial services, an organization called TransferWise, which has challenged the status quo of transferring money across borders. It's a UK-based company which now has backing from Richard Branson, where you can transfer money across borders without any transaction fees that the banks typically charge. And in the alcohol space, for instance, there's a company called Brewdog, which is a punk IPA brand. They make ales. And they have challenged in many ways the foundation of what it stands to be beer. They produce some of the strongest beers in the world, going up to more than 50% alcohol content, which is actually higher than whiskey, and challenging the regulators in the model in which they're operating. And to an extent in India, there are organizations like Bira, which have really challenged the market leaders in the way in which they're operating and gained a popularity. So I would argue that those are sort of some of the brands and models that are challenger brands today.
Thanks. That's a lot of challengers sitting here with their perspectives on things. It's interesting because everybody seems to have a point on what they see differently as a challenger, right? So there's somebody says, you were rightly saying, market leader can also be a challenger, etc. So if we had to put on a challenger hat, or if you had to build a challenger hat, what attributes do you see that you need to have in them? Like one attribute that's very important to build a challenger hat that I need to wear.
I think there are I can start. There are several, but I think I will focus on how do you describe your target audience, and how do you describe your attitude. Let me put it this way. Target audience, in fact, when you actually challenge a brand, you can't go very large, very wide. So it is very important that you define your target audience very, very clearly. And maybe rather than other examples, I can share our own examples coming from 2YUM. So we define our target audience as guilty snackers. By the way, 2YUM is a healthy snacking brand. We are baked and not fried. And just to give you a context, 95% of the snacking options available today in the country are fried. So every young consumer who is conscious about their health, either they eat snacks in moderation or they balance it off by saying, chalo abhi kha lete, baad mein I'll go for a walk or I'll go to the gym or I'll run it out or I'll have a smaller meal in the mealtime. And that's how they always are guilty, very conscious, and they try to moderate or compensate. So if we actually define our TG as guilty snackers, then suddenly, you know, everything starts to fall into place. If you take this as an insight, then your communication actually addresses that. The innovations or whatever products that you do addresses that. The claims that that you will make will address that. But also, where are these guilty snackers? What is relevant to them? Because they are somewhat health conscious, then sports as a genre interests them because it's about health and fitness. Travel, and you know, of course, these are mostly young. So humor, music, these are the platforms which actually interest them. So suddenly the whole description starts to come together. But if you were to say a mainstream brand in snacking like Lay's or say Bingo, they will address everybody. So it is very, very, very generic and wide. But when you describe your TG audience, it becomes very, very specific. Because there is a very high chance that when you talk to them, the reaction and the engagement is much larger. So I think this is one key criteria that you define your TG very, very clearly. Second is, and I'll just possibly talk about two. Second is agility. I mean, you have to move very, very fast. Try fast, fail fast is really a challenger mindset because you are experimenting. You know, you might have a view, you might have a thought that maybe this can work, but it is not proven because you are disrupting the norms and disrupting the convention. So you are always trying, it may work, it may not work. And that's why the idea is to experiment fast, do it to a smaller scale perhaps. And even if you fail, the damage is not that much. So I think defining your core TG very, very clearly and having a very nimble and agile way of operating are the two that I would highlight.
So I have a little different take on that. I think what is important in my view is to understand the customer pain point, which has not been addressed. And that TG might not be niche also. For example, in our case, when we said, okay, people don't want to pay brokerage, that TG is not niche. That is a very, very large TG. Actually, no one wants to pay brokerage, right? So But I think the pain point was huge because, like I said, 1,40,000 crores of hard-earned money going to a broker who's saying, sir, iska phone number ye, aapko milwa deta hun. Iske liye ye 1,40,000 crores is going.
Pause it there. You need to get me a notax.com also.
So I think that customer pain point is something which is very critical whenever you're thinking of a challenger brand. Second, again, from our example, I think resilience is very important because when you're disrupting something, there'll be going to be a side effect for that. I think so, Sai was just mentioning that somebody spoke to told that once we started No Broker, within a year, some 50 brokers came and attacked our office and started ransacking that. Now, for almost 3 months after that, we were working from makeshift office. We didn't have a desk. We were working on mattresses for almost 2 months. But I think what was important was that the entire team believed in the vision that we have to remove brokerage. The entire team came across much, much stronger. And I think one conviction that, yes, we're doing something right. That's why people are reacting to it. So that resilience is also very important when you're disrupting something, when you're challenging something.
I'm going to answer this question by referring to a story that we probably heard when we were in school. So it's about David and Goliath. So I worked both in the corporate sector as well as in the startup sector. I've been an entrepreneur for the last 6 years. So when I was in the corporate sector, you know, everybody referred to David versus Goliath. And Goliath is this big giant. And David is this small shepherd boy who happened to kill, Goliath. So every time in the meetings that we went, everybody is referred to, you know, be the David, you know, go and disrupt, you know, defeat the Goliath and stuff like that. When I became an entrepreneur, I realized there was another side to that story. And that side was basically 99 times out of the 100 times that David fights Goliath, Goliath always wins. They'll never tell you, but Goliath always wins. But there's one time that, you know, David will win. And then I started, you know, thinking to myself, why the hell did David win? There were two things. One is he used a slingshot. It was his weapon of choice. It was something that he's understood. It was something that he's used before, and he's something which is comfortable with. The second thing was he knew what Goliath's weakness was. Goliath couldn't move that fast. If it was a level playing field, and then Goliath and David had to fight with swords, David would have lost. In any other matter, however you play it out, it is highly possible that, you know, David loses. So when I became an entrepreneur, the two things that I wanted to focus on was, what is my strength? What is my strong point? What is my slingshot? And for me, that was the access to the South market that we had. It was my team. It was the ability to work in a very, you know, agile environment as much as possible. And the second thing was understand my, the competitor's weakness. And that was very clear because, you know, the national narrative was not focused on the southern space. So these two things, I think, is something that if you can get out of your head in the beginning stages of when you start your career or, you know, start your entrepreneurship journey, I think that plays a huge role in defining what kind of a product you become at a later stage.
I think it was a fantastic anecdote, kind of, you know, summarizes this pretty much. But, you know, I don't know if it's an attribute, but one thing I think it a challenge band should do is kind of keep making the leader brand uncomfortable. So if someone who keeps making the leader brand uncomfortable or keeps nudging them or makes them think that, you know, oh, why didn't we do it? And of course, when they kind of find out that, oh, challenger brand has done this and they put more monies and kind of, you know, overtake them, that's fine. But challenger brand is someone, these are attributes which I think are very, very prominent where, you know, they keep nudging the leader brand to, why can't they kind of, you know, keep quiet for a while? So an example which from our side was which made the financial services, the banks and everyone think that why didn't we think about it, or our competitors, why didn't we think about it, was we were the marketplace for we're now the largest marketplace for loans, but like 6 years back we weren't. The model was very simple. People used to come to a platform, compare, choose for the best loan, and then that customer used to go to the bank. Two problems used to happen. 8 out of 10 consumers never used to get a loan, and the bank used to say, yeah, the same thing, that 8 out of 10 of your customers don't get a loan. And the reason for both used to be low, poor credit score. And this problem was happening for a lot of marketplaces. But we came with an innovation that, you know, how do we solve this? So we brought in the entire credit score to our platform, and we started running the largest credit score program in the country, wherein if you have to take a credit score from the CIBIL or anyone else, you have to pay 500 rupees. But on our platform, it's absolutely free. So when a consumer comes to my platform, A, he checks the credit score, and he, at the moment he gets to know his if his credit score is good, then he gets, we say that, you know, you have a very strong chance of approval. So we solved two problems. We solved the partner problem, we solved the consumer problem. And that, and it also became a great customer acquisition strategy. You know, free credit score was there, and the education around the entire credit score was very weak in India. So we solved the bank problem, we solved this problem, and a lot of people started thinking the same way and also started following this the pattern. But we were not leader at that point of time. But we're pretty much large at this point. But we also now believe that even if you're a leader, but you also always should have a mindset of a challenger. I don't know if it's an attribute, but when you keep making a leader uncomfortable, that's something which I think could be an attribute.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of grain of truth in that thing of agility and making people uncomfortable. And that, in essence, a lot of challenger brands, and there is a distinction between challenger brands and disruptors, but I'm clubbing it to an extent because the mindset is very similar. It is a questioning attitude that you need to take to establish norms, whether that be regulation, that be consumers, and the way in which they operate. I mean, Sony, when they came up with their Walkman at that time, right? Nascent needs or things like that. There are, even in today's environment, a lot of brands which are looking at things in a completely different way. There is an organization, for instance, in India, which is now a unicorn, called Rivigo, which is a trucking logistics company. And what they essentially looked at is the core problem of consumers, large organizations, and the truckers themselves. One of the fundamental issues that trucking had, and people were moving away from the profession of trucking because there was a sense of pride that was not associated with it. You were traveling on the roads for 4 or 5 days, never at home, moving from place to place, not with the family. There was rampant prostitution, there was AIDS, there was alcohol problems, etc., all of that. And they brought a very simple model from another industry like airlines, which is a hub and spoke model, which is to do a relay trucking. So you sort of, if you're going from Bombay, you travel 200 kilometers, you pick up another truck and travel back to wherever the destination is. We changed the entire perception and the speed and agility in the way in which the entire logistics operations were working. It gets rid of the whole sort of road tax problems. This is pre-GST, etc. And a lot of it often seems with a challenger brand, when you look at where they finally reach, why didn't somebody else think of that? And that's what a challenger brand brings to the table, is this constant need for questioning the status quo and doing things differently and continuing to do that in very different ways. I mean, you move from that to then saying, how can I leverage technology to do something very differently? How can I be more agile? And the advantage that it has over embedded brands is the speed at which they can operate, because embedded brands will take longer to change the nature of their operations. It's like a big tank moving, like the David and Goliath analogy, I think. And I think that's a fundamental attribute of a challenger brand.
Thanks. It's interesting because the number of times I heard the word agility across this entire panel, it's definitely the most key attribute as people are talking about it, right? So if you were to look at agility, and because that word's come up, and you said David and Goliath, I have this very interesting question, because it's then when it comes to a challenger mindset, right? When you look at startups, it's very easy to wear that challenger mindset and turn around and say this, because agility, David and Goliath, these words are what you associate with a startup. But then when it comes to established big conglomerates, right? How does it work in that scenario? How do you wear a challenger hat? And I think, Anupam, you can answer this best, because part of an RPG group, it's as a startup, I know it's easier to wear this hat. The fail fast syndrome works. Here, how do you work on the same syndrome here?
Yeah, I think the large corporate's DNA does prevent you from doing something very disruptive. And by the way, it's not wrong, to be honest. It is just the scale and size is so huge that getting it wrong can have huge damages and losses. And that's why I think there is a bit of checks and balances, a bit of research which needs to be validated before you actually take an initiative. And I'm talking more from a Unilever point of view. But if there are areas where you feel that the risk is low, but there is a real need to actually change convention, then you can also do that. I can share challenger initiatives happening in every large organization as well, but maybe the entire organization doesn't behave that way. And I can share an example, more relevant because it's coming from my own experience. We used to work on a brand called Purit. One of my Purit team members is here. Both are in different organizations now. And this was, it was a challenger by design because good quality water purifiers were coming at least 5,000, 6,000 rupees. And then when Purit was launched, it was launched at 1,800 rupees without any constraints of piped water or electricity or what have you. And I think that was a great innovation. But suddenly, by the way, every challenger can also find a new challenger in the fullness of time or in due course. And then this was a time when Tata Swatch was about to launch. The poster child or poster celebrity was Ratan Tata himself, and he came on saying that we want to disrupt this and we want to give a purifier at 1,000 rupees. And suddenly we were scared. And so what do we do? So it was, August of 2009 when this announcement was made. So actually suddenly a Goliath like Unilever got into a very David or a challenger mode. And we said, we can't let this happen because it was certainly a demise for Purit if there was a purifier launching at half the price. So we got the team together. We put a device at 1,000 rupees. It was called Purit Compact. By the way, a water purifier has at least 20, 30, 40 molded components. So it takes that much time to create molds, design it. But everything was done. We actually designed it with no time. We created a pilot mold, which could give you a few lakh pieces, but not more than that. And that was done. The molding happened in a third shift, which we never used to run in the molding department. And hence, it was suddenly extra time and capacity created, and the molding was done. We created a prototype, just a prototype design, and we created 5-6 of them. We did trade conferences. And before the first Purit Compact was manufactured, 50,000 Purit Compacts were sold, booked just by showing the prototype. So August 2009, when the announcement was made by Ratan Tata, mid-Jan 2010, Purit Compact was launched. Tata Swatch launched in March, and that's it. It never got launched only. So I think, the scare of what can happen to you and whether we can attitudinally just transform and apply the team, look at innovative ways of creating that capacity and doing it was one such example. So I think to answer your question, yes, it's not very easy, but there are pockets where this thing happened. Come to think of it, even if you look at large brands and brands which have got and categories which have got massive penetration, you will have very generic growth of the category coming to your brand. But if you want to have discontinuous lifts in your growth, then you have to still wear the hat of a challenger mindset. Is there a new way to address that need? Is there a faster way? Is there a more convenient way? And actually, when you actually start to say, okay, how can I improve the solution to that particular need? Innovation will happen. And then suddenly, you are the biggest guy, but you can still challenge what the established norms are and take your brand to the next level. So I think this can happen in large companies as well.
Does anybody else have?
It's interesting because as you were talking, I was just realizing that the largest advantage that a challenger brand brings to the market is actually to the consumer. And it really depends on what the purpose of the organization is in what they want to achieve. From the perspective of what your brand purpose is in essence, and it goes back to that. Had Tata's, for instance, not looked at launching Swatch, and I mean, Unilever always had the opportunity to do a Purit Compact. Unilever would never have done that till there's another challenger. So a lot of large organizations are forced to innovate because somebody comes up as a challenger. And if your brand purpose, for instance, and it depends how you define it, do you... for example, get into the market saying that I want to sell the largest number of water purifiers, or do you want to get into the market and say I want to be able to create accessible cheap water for a large swath of the population, irrespective of whether I'm doing it or somebody else is doing it? Can I disrupt the market so that the brand purpose is getting fulfilled? I've worked on a couple of sort of projects within the Tata Group myself, which have had various different levels of success and failure. One of my first projects which I worked on was the Nano, right? And that started off with the same kind of mindset, is the purpose of saying, you know, how do you ensure that people have a safe mode of transport versus the two-wheeler model? But it forced the entire industry in a way, even though the Nano in itself didn't end up selling because of a large number of other macroeconomic and environmental and political, et cetera, issues. Or Jinja Hotels, for instance, when it was in a very entrepreneurial stage. And now there are a number of other brands in that. And I think that that is something that the challenger brings to the table, even if the challenger is a leader, that ultimately the consumer benefits from. And that is why it's very important for consumers to continue to be evangelists of challenger brands, because they will benefit from that the most, the likes of a no-broker. You know, ultimately it is the consumer who's getting the benefit of that, because there's an economic surplus that a leader or a challenger who's come out with the market is exploiting. So it's almost a democratization of that a challenger is bringing to the table.
This is for you, because considering you don't have any competition. So what I've seen is, you know, most of the time in the larger organizations, especially like in HUL and all that, I think it's because of the nagging of the second, you know, player and the third player that, you know, you're forced to, you know, wear a challenger hat. So what do you do?
So I think very interesting. So we started as a platform to connect owners, tenants, buyers, sellers directly without a middleman. But I think, like I mentioned, for us the most important thing was looking at the customer pain point. And once we started doing these closures, we realized that, you know, apart from paying the brokerage, customer had a lot of other pain points. One was, okay, I found the house, but broker used to get my rent agreement done. Broker used to get my legal documentation done. Then they said, okay, so we started doing rent agreements, we started doing legal documentation. Then they said, okay, that's fine, but you know, I'm buying a home, but I need a home loan. I need a packer and mover, I need interior services, I need a, you know, multiple other things. So now no broker is a one-stop shop. You can find all these things on the platform. And very recently, almost less than a year back, so we spoke to a lot of consumers and we realized that there is a pain in paying rent also. There's a lot of friction in that. People said, okay, I have to every month go onto the website. A lot of times it's cash and, you know, stuff like that. So we launched a platform called No Broker Pay. You can go, you can put your owner's details, you can put your details, you can pay through any means. You can pay through credit card, you can pay through UPI. And it's less than a year. Every month, more than 500 crores is paid on as rent on No Broker platform through that means. So I think my biggest thing is that keep listening to what the customer is saying. Keep listening to his pain points and keep on innovating. Otherwise, if we don't do that, somebody else will do it.
So if you keep listening to customers, and we need to keep improving, everybody's talking about wanting to be a challenger, right? Now, if you look at it, at some point, does the challenger brand itself become a crowded market? Now, like, I can ask you this question, Siddharth, because coming from aviation, I think every brand in the aviation segment right now is acting as a challenger brand. So there were airlines, and then somebody challenged it and said, let's make a low-cost airline. Now somebody's come back as Vistara, saying that let's come back with the old airline. Kingfisher tried the, oh, let's disrupt it and challenge the stylish art of flying. So if everybody is trying to challenge, does this become a stagnated space? Where are you at right now when it comes to how do you disrupt this market?
I think it does. I think if everybody becomes, essentially somebody comes in and challenges the market norms, and then the entire market moves in that direction, because it sees that there's a differentiating opportunity over there. But if everybody is differentiating on the same space, which, for example, is where the aviation industry right now is in India, right? Everybody came in and is differentiating on cost, and the consumer mindset therefore becomes that I need to purchase on the basis of price. That is not a margin-enhancing game. And therefore, it is imperative upon somebody else to come and bring a value proposition to the market that a consumer is willing to pay a premium for. And that, I think, is the crux of what a challenger brand needs to be able to do, because it's easy to challenge a status quo if you're challenging it without making a profit. But how do you sustain yourself as an organization over a period of time? I mean, Uber has done that with the gig economy. It's very challenging, etc. But it's not profit making. If you look at a large number of players in the online space, e-commerce space across the world, the largest companies in the world challenge our mindsets, but they're not profit making. Can you be a challenger and sustain over an extended period of time? That is where you're a true challenger, because it's easy. I mean, the telecom industry has had enough challenges in the market. But what is it achieved, either for the consumer or in the larger space for the organizations themselves?
I think adding to his point, for example, a hotel industry, which I can think of, you know, so people try to do multiple things, like you mentioned, Ginger was there, or across the world, there were hotels and they were affordable hotels. But I think what Airbnb did, it just spinned the entire thing into a totally different kind of a proposition, which was very appealing to the customers, because they wanted that authentic experience. They didn't want it to be the same, same thing everywhere they're going. And at the same time, for the owners who had that extra capacity, it became a great business model. So in a space like hotels, where everybody was trying to do something very, very similar, Airbnb just spinned it into something totally different.
So keeping this, so when we were doing this talk, right, so I was looking at the research and I was kind of looking up challenger brands, because everybody is suddenly speaking about challenger brands. These are not brands that were born yesterday, right? It's probably 2014, 2012, and they are coming into the limelight today. And when you look at what has brought them out, so there's disruption. One of the key disruption has been, say, for example, for consumer goods, it's primarily been distribution, right? So older, bigger companies own the distribution pipeline. Today, that got disrupted with e-commerce. Multiple new challenger brands existed there. Marketing became a whole point. Social media, right? When that came in, a lot of people started using social to build their brands. They said that, hey, this is suddenly I have access to social capital, which is free of cost, etc. Today, we are sitting at a time where nothing is free. Even social media is not free anymore. So the organic reach has died. There is still the need for the newer brands to come in to apply a frugal strategy at some point, a media strategy of sorts. So do you guys, I mean, because you guys have all built brands in the challenger aspect of things, do you see how you can counter this? Like, Vignesh, maybe you could help with this, because the organic reach, say, for example, on Facebook is close to nil. How do you today disrupt or challenge the new age other media brands?
We obviously realized from the beginning that distribution was going to be a problem. When we started out, Facebook was very kind. Our engagement and reach on Facebook was really, really good. And over the period of years, they made some algorithm changes. And then after that, like you said, in 2020 right now, if you don't pay any kind of money, your content will never be discovered. Google, on the other hand, is a lot more better. I hope Facebook, Google people are not here, right? So anyway, so they have an organic platform called Discovery, which is on your, basically on any kind of Chrome app. I mean, not app, but the Chrome browser on your phone. So if you go scroll down, you'll see a bunch of content suggestions and stuff like that. So how do you get onto that platform? You can only get onto that, and then you can only make sure that your organic reach is high if your content is unique. I've always believed that content is king. Luckily for us, a lot of the national publishers are still not focusing on the southern markets. When is the last time you got to know of a big political development in Tamil Nadu or a Karnataka? I'm asking you guys over here. After Jayalalitha died, I don't think there's been a lot of coverage on what's happening in Karnataka politics, in Tamil Nadu politics, or even Kerala politics. Just to give you an example, in 2015, when Chennai was under floods, and it was a very drastic situation that the people in Chennai were facing. Floods. When I say floods, like water was breaching the first story and the second story of people's houses. It took 3 days for the national narrative to actually come and reach Chennai and then do a ground story. For us, it's always been stick true to the values of journalism that we believe in. A ground story does travel a lot more than somebody sitting out of Delhi and Bombay and reporting on the same kind of story. Cultural sensitivity. has worked big time for us. We understand the people that we are reporting on. We understand the issues that we are reporting on a lot better than people sitting away from the where the issue is. When you stick to these things, and then you know you're able to put out content on a regular manner. You know, you can't just come and put one story today and then you know forget about it. I think it'll travel by itself, and we've been blessed with getting a lot more distribution happen, you know, through that way. And we're not totally, you know, reliant on social media anymore.
My just two cents on this is, for any internet company, we follow this very simple rule of reducing dependency on Google and Facebook, and build your brand, build direct traffic, acquire consumers, and do CRM very strongly. So over a period of time, we have a rule of, you know, 60-40. The day your direct traffic becomes 60%, you're like making into real serious business, because that's direct traffic is equal to, in the FMCG world, is equal to a TOMA. So the more you build brand, the more direct traffic increases for internet business, and that 60-40 rule kind of we follow, and build brand, do CRM, and reduce dependency on paid. That kind of that rule kind of works for us.
Well, I think you can. Oh, okay. Yeah, sure.
So I think also unique to your business, you have to think of what I think is jugaad. I think that's something a challenger brand or a disruptor also has to think of. In our case, we realized that very early that supply comes first. So you need to bring owners and sellers first. It's easier to bring buyers and tenants. But how do we bring these guys? These are guys who are 40 plus, who are not online, who are not searching on Google, Facebook, I don't know. So what we did was that when we were very, very small, we used to go and click these pictures, because a lot of the owners and sellers put a for sale or to let board outside their house with their number saying, no brokers, please. So we started clicking these pictures, come back to our office, call these guys and get the properties listed. When we started growing up, we thought that we have to do something about this because it's a large number of properties. So what we did was that we opened our app that anybody who sees these to let board or for sale board can actually click that picture, upload on our app, and it comes to our call center through an OCR, and they call the owner, list the property, if it is listed, 100 rupees in their Paytm account. So now, as of today, we get almost 30,000 such properties every month. There are people who are students, every day they take out their bike, click 20 pictures, get their pocket money. There are people who are delivery boys who have quit their job, who are doing this full time. So at a very, very low cost, I'm able to bring that, because a similar cost of bringing it otherwise on other platforms, people have paid more than 1,000 rupees, and I'm able to get it in 100 rupees. So I think some kind of disruptive thinking, some kind of jugaad, I think that is also required to make sure that your marketing cost is low.
Can I add just one? Sure. I think it's this is coming from FMCG. So I think, and there are various ways you can leverage the assets that you invest in. And I mean, just focus on what assets you want to create and where you want to make the investment, and whether those assets can be leveraged to really create awareness and reach. Again, coming from our example, so like Virat Kohli has a cumulative fan following across social platforms of 85 million, and he's your brand endorser. What would you do? So then you don't really have to invest in buying social space. You have to really create content which interests his 85 million followers. And suddenly, when Virat was getting married and a lot of talk was going on, that's the time when we seeded 2YUM as a brand, and we created some communication which was more teaser-based and then a solution-based. And you know, in 3 days, we got some 30 million views. It was more than the views that his wedding got. So it's like, just create content which is disruptive, which is again breaking the convention. How can you expect Virat to really eat snacks? You know, he's such a fitness icon. But actually, he has been seen munching on chips. And what is his newfound love when he's getting married? And actually just seed that content. 85 million followers are following, 3 days, 30 million. One of the most viewed content as the top 10 contents, brand equity and all publishes on a monthly basis, and that's where you go. So either you are able to create momentum by yourself or leverage something as a property which actually has momentum.
IPL is one such big event. So you can do something around it disruptively, and the followers of that will have it. Kumbh was another event where suddenly, you know, you have something like 15 crore visitors to Kumbh every year. And actually we created something called the world's largest oil lamp. It's a Guinness record. But because, you know, creating something disruptive caught the attention and we got free publicity. So I think PR as a pillar is something which can be used very well. Invest and then leverage through the fan following that is there. And I think you can bypass some of the social media costs to achieve it.
Thanks. Well, I think we've run out of time. I had one last question which I actually wanted to ask, because that's been our biggest debate for the last 1 hour that we were talking about. But maybe I'll ask the question here. You guys can think about it. If you want to find some time outside, we could even gather this. The question was, can a market leader be a challenger? So we were debating about it, saying, so you talked about how Apple was a challenger brand at one point, but Apple was, and then OnePlus became a challenger brand. And then OnePlus became a leader, and Xiaomi became a challenger brand. So can a market leader continue to be a challenger, or can a challenger only be number two, number three, number four, who is always probably working harder? That was the question. I don't know if you have time, though.
That would be the last one.
yeah, I think we can take a couple of answers, can we?
Yeah, we can, yes. Now that you asked the question, we should take a couple of answers.
If anybody has two answers.
I think a market leader can be a challenger. The two examples for that, which I talked about, Craigslist, I think it's bigger than anybody else in terms of classified space. It's a market leader, but still a challenger. Airbnb, again, I think, very, very large, still doing things very differently than what other people are doing. So I think it's the problem which you're solving. It's the mind space which you're addressing. That is what defines a challenger, not the market share, probably.
See, from my perspective, when Apple became the leader, I think this was when they launched iPhone 5, around that time, 4, 5, and 6, or whatever. So if you look at the iPhone 6, 7, and 8, and all that had that button over there, that was the time when all the other challenger brands came with full screen displays. It took, Apple, I think, 4 or 5 years before they actually realized that, maybe we should make a phone without a, push button and then keep the entire display. I think that's where they failed in being a challenger. You know, when you knew that the market was inching towards something else, they didn't read the customer properly, they didn't realize, and that's when they started losing out on a lot of market share. I mean, now I think they're back to number one. But I think it's high time that every single leader brand, especially being nudged, when they're nudged by the smaller brands, that they take it a lot more important and make sure that, they become challengers in themselves. Stagnation is probably the, end point of anything, brand, career, any kind of innovation.
Great. Thank you.